Good morning. Just a quick note observation. This went out in the newsletter on Thursday, but at the recommendation of our COVID committee, the session voted in favor of removing our mask requirement measurement. That puts us at this level of mask optional, mask friendly. Of course, do whatever you need to do to feel comfortable and safe when you're at Trinity. But it is refreshing to see some of y'all's faces, full faces, from up here. The story of Jesus includes many moments around tables, as this was part of his ritual of relationship, even to the end. In this fifth week of the Lenten season, we will hear a story of love and of devotion from the disciple, Mary, directed at Jesus at the table. As we will see, Jesus tries to prepare his beloved companions for his death. Talk of death is like a gut punch to many of us. We would rather believe we and our loved ones are invincible, are able to will ourselves into being strong. We all know that that isn't always how the story goes. Today, we proclaim that we are fragile, and our lives, like the plants in the gardens we tend, are susceptible to elemental dangers and a life cycle of letting go in order to live. Friends, the Lord be with you. Let us worship God.
Thank you. Please stand for the call of worship. Holy One, lover of souls, we call out to you. You know our tears and sorrows, and you bear the seeds of grief with us. Open us this day to your comfort that nurtures these seeds into sheaves of joy.
May be seated. Jesus speaks words no one wanted to admit. He was not always going to be around. Oh, don't say that, so many of us have said to a loved one who speaks the truth about the fragility of life. Perhaps we get uncomfortable because it reveals the precious nature of the present moment, laying bare the beauty and the horror of it all. The pain we know we will one day face invades our sense like a pervasive perfume, inescapable. What if we stopped denying the limited nature of our lives and breathed in deeply the fragrance of vulnerability? Friends, please join me in the prayer for forgiveness, which is printed in your bulletin. Like Judas, God of new things, we like to complain about your generous ways rather than living in your grace. In our memories, we see a perceived golden past, and so we close our eyes to the new things you do in our midst. Forgive us, restoring God, and help us to notice the kingdom springing forth around us. By your grace, may our fears turn to faith. Our seeds of grief produce a bumper crop of joy, and our tears turn into torrents of tenderness as we journey with Jesus Christ to Jerusalem. Amen. Friends, hear this compassionate word from Paul's letter to the Philippians. I want to know, friends. Wonderful. Another reminder, we're all children in God's eyes. This is a time for everybody, but thank you for coming forward. Oh, hello. Welcome, welcome. Oh, goodness. Hey, y'all. Y'all had a good weekend, and yesterday was a big day in Starkville. I see some remaining face paint. to remind us of the joy that happened in our town. So today's story from the Bible is a meal of Jesus and his friends, and Jesus is getting ready to go to Jerusalem, where that Palm Sunday parade happens, and everybody shouts Hosanna and welcomes Jesus into Jerusalem. And so with that, his friends are also concerned because they think that he might die soon. And they're trying to figure out what to do to maybe make that better, to feel better. And Mary, his friend, does something kind of strange. She takes some really expensive perfume that probably cost a whole year's worth of money from work, and she actually pours it on Jesus' feet, and then she takes her hair, and she washes Jesus' feet with her hair and the expensive perfume, and the Bible tells us that the smell of the perfume just radiated throughout the room. For me, it kind of reminds me of, like, if we think of the perfume as an act of love, a kind of strange act of love from Mary, we think of that smell. For me, I think of when somebody bakes brownies for me when I'm not feeling well or I had a bad day, and how good that smell makes me feel. Do y'all have a favorite smell that reminds you of happiness or of people loving you? Yeah. Yeah. Warm cookies. Yeah. Baked goods are always... Yeah, I know some people will, on special Sundays for communion, sometimes it's fun to actually bring in fresh baked bread to remind us of God's love with the smell of that bread. And so I think it's a very unique and different story of an act of love, but I hope it helps us think of ways that we can show love to people around us who are sick or hurting or are sad, and how special those memories are, especially when we can smell and remember specific moments. I know I've heard stories from some of these adults whose parents are no longer here because they've passed away, but they remember the smell of their mother's perfume or of their father's cologne and how special that feels to them. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of our senses, the things that we're able to touch and eat and smell and see and taste. Help us to use all of our senses to feel your love around us. Amen. Thanks, y'all. We'll now sing our hymn of gathering, number 828, More Love to Thee, O Christ. Thank you.
Speak with authority in our lives, Christ. Speak to us and to what is in us, so that we may be whole. Speak to us with love, with hope, and with strength, so that we might hear you and know deep inside that we are your people and that you are our God. Let it be so. Amen.
Our reading from the Hebrew Scriptures is Psalm 126. Listen now to the word of God. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. And then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the water courses in the Negev. May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy. Those who go out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, carrying their sheaves. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Remember the 60s, maybe remember Peter, Paul, and Mary, and this is one of their songs called All My Trials.
All my trials, Lord.
Thank you. Our second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. Listen again to the word of God. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him, and Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray Jesus, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I want to note that our theme this week is we are fragile. We are heading toward Holy Week, to Christ's death on the cross, and are continuing to think a bit about our own realities. And speaking about loss and death in any capacity can expectedly or unexpectedly launch our imaginations and memories into a flurry of images and words having to do with our own relationships in this world. I don't think we talk about death as Christians living in the United States often enough. It has become a taboo subject, but a topic that I believe we'll regret not talking about and getting the chance to approach it. And so, not surprisingly, this morning's sermon and scripture handles such difficult topics as feels appropriate when journeying toward the events of Good Friday, but I'm acutely aware that our church's prayer list is the longest it's been since I arrived here in October. And so I invite you to recognize your own fragility this morning. If there comes a point when you need to take a break, it's a beautiful morning out there, just step outside and go sit over there on that porch and watch the sunshine and get some fresh air. And when you're ready, you can return and we'll celebrate communion together as one body. And know that I am here, we are all here for you if you need an ear or a heart after worship. We are all fragile. Be gentle and give yourself what you need today. For a long time, one of the careers that has always fascinated me is the job of the doula. Traditionally, doulas guide a woman and others she chooses to be with her during the birthing process. Unlike a midwife who provides medical care during pregnancy, labor, an immediate postpartum period, doulas provide emotional, physical, and educational support during these times. One website describes the distinction between the two, with a midwife as a healthcare provider, while a doula is more of a childbirth coach. The official role of the doula is a relatively newly popular one, having become popular in the 80s. And I'm gradually discovering other types of doula that are being recognized beyond the birth doula. Such types include a transition doula, one who walks alongside a person receiving gender-affirming transitions, an indigenous doula, one who holds space for indigenous clients and tries to find resources and medicine associated with their specific tribal territory or nation. There's the death doula, one who works with folks at the end of their lives or with the family members experiencing loss. The death doula, sometimes called an end-of-life doula, is the one who gathers rituals and plans to bring comfort and relief to the dying and their grieving families. The websites for the International End-of-Life Doula Association has this to say about their work. Serving as an end-of-life doula can make a huge difference in the lives of dying people and their loved ones. It is not because you will always help make the process, or at least moments of it, beautiful and peaceful, although that can happen, but because even in the inevitable messiness and suffering of dying, you can walk alongside people in a way that allows them to get back up after breaking down, to find a way through their pain to accept the inevitability and naturalness of dying, to return to the bedside with a renewed tenderness and compassion, to find a richer vein of meeting in what can be so hard to go through and to witness. These are the gifts doulas bring. End-of-life doulas give dignity to the dying and help communities name the reality of their own mortality while helping us all make meaning of it. When I think of Mary's anointing of Jesus' feet, I see her behaving in a way an end-of-life doula might. Even in the messiness and suffering, she walks alongside Jesus in a way that will hopefully restore him a bit. Mary sees the writing on the wall. She sees where they are headed, and she responds to her fragility with this beautiful, unique act of service. Like Mary, searching for something to do to ritualize her grief, we are all fragile. This is likely not a new truth for most of us. If we didn't already know it on our own, we were abruptly forced to reckon with that fragility when the pandemic began in a variation of ways. In his storytelling, John attempts to make a clear juxtaposition between Mary and Judas. Mary, the fragile and generous one, and Judas, the tight-fisted and judgmental one. And Christ stands up for Mary. Christ sees Mary's vulnerability, her eyes welling with tears, her offering of the costly perfume for a foot bath, her own hair to dry in between his toes, and says, Christ sees these. Oh, sorry. And Christ sees these and hears Judas's admonition. And Christ says, leave her alone. Leave her alone. Let her cry. Let her do what she needs to do to process this. John gives us a parenthetical explanation for Judas's outburst. He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. But I can't help but wonder if Judas's response to Mary's action is a sign that he himself is grieving and trying to push down his own fragility in this situation, in this moment. Jesus had just resuscitated a dead Lazarus. This was really going to set off a frenzy among the leaders and rulers in the area, and this was probably going to be the straw that broke the camel's back for Christ's ministry on earth. And Judas and Mary and their friends all knew it. Maybe Judas was suggesting giving the denarii to the poor. Maybe he was proposing a memorial gift in Christ's name to honor his clear affection and preference for the poor. Maybe he just wasn't ready to see such a ritual. He was hoping that they'd have a few more months together to wash Christ's feet in tears, and that doing it now would seal his fate to happen sooner than Judas was prepared for. Almost unbearable tenderness, as one commentary puts Mary's act of care for Jesus. Perhaps that tenderness really was unbearable for Judas to witness. Anyone who has grieved with their family knows how confusing or disorienting it can be to see a loved one responding to their pain in a way that you would never respond to your pain. Whether he's going back to work too soon or she's staying in her pajamas too long, it's easy to fall into the trap that it seems Judas has fallen into. So maybe Jesus isn't reprimanding Judas for his carelessness and his judgment. What if Jesus is hoping that Judas will see his own need to process the events that are happening around him and the events that are yet to come? Maybe Jesus is grateful that Mary seems to get what their friend group is about to endure together. Maybe he's hoping that Judas and others will give themselves the room to approach the elephant in the room as well. We don't always get the time to prepare for a loved one's departure like Jesus' friends did leading to the crucifixion. For lack of better phrasing, deaths where we get to prepare for some time, deaths where that happen at a normal age, are often our best case scenario, and I don't like using that phrase. It's a bittersweet gift to be able to walk and sit with someone through those stages, but we don't always receive that bittersweet gift, and that will leave us feeling even more fragile. So what if our best case scenario is not the nature or the timing, but the extent to which we are liberated enough from our taboos and from our false robustness to the point of being able to embrace what we uniquely need in order to dwell in our sometimes wordless agony and sorrow. What Mary does, pouring perfume that would have cost a year's salary on Jesus' feet and washing them with her hair, makes no sense. It wasn't really a sacred ritual in the way that she did it. Jesus didn't ask her to do it for him. But Jesus endorses her senseless action. Jesus says yes to her seemingly fruitless expression of sorrow and tells the rest of their table companions that they won't be able to sit in spaces like these with him forever. Maybe here, Jesus standing up for us in our grief and our sorrow. Jesus saying, he is not hurting anyone, let him do it. She is doing the best she can do. They need time. They need this moment to process and to heal. Whether we are our own Judases telling us that we are wasting our time or that we shouldn't continue to be hung up on this, or we have Judases around us telling us that the emotions we are feeling are the wrong ones or that we should use different words, know that Jesus sees us and our fragility and smiles softly in admiration of our ability to not flee from it, but to reside in the fragile moments of life. All glory be to the Creator Christ and Holy Spirit. Amen. Having heard the word read and proclaimed, let us rise in body or in spirit to together affirm our faith using words from the Apostles' Creed, which is printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. may be seated. Remembering that all that we have and all that we are is a gift from God entrusted to our care for but a season, let us return to God a portion of what we have been so generously given with our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Generous God, in light of your extravagant blessings, no matter what the state of the world or our imperfect lives, we offer our gifts and ourselves and know that you transform what we plant into the produce of love. Amen. You may be seated. Because our prayers of the people fall into the communion liturgy, we don't get our usual chance right before to share prayer concerns. So we'll do that now before approaching the table. Added to our list this week, which was in the weekly email, a former member of Trinity and dear friend, Carolyn Goodman, was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer this week and is beginning palliative treatment. Is there anybody else we are praying for this week?
Family of Dr. Terry Ambery,
who passed on Friday.
Say the name again.
Terry Ambery.
Passed. All right. Thank you. Margaret Bateman, diagnosed with cancer. Great, thank you. We do maintain a list of prayer concerns within and around our community, and that is in the weekly email. If you don't receive that, feel free to let me know after worship, and we'll get you added to that list. Christ looks upon each one of us with love and says, "You are welcome at my table." Christ looks upon each one of us with compassion and says, "Whatever troubles you, bring it here." Christ looks upon each one of us with grace and says, "Whatever you'd like to leave behind, do so here." Will you come? Will you bring your troubles? Will you shed all that is unnecessary in your life? This is the place, this place at the table where you don't need to be perfect. You don't need to be sure of yourself or of your faith. You don't need to feel whole and right with the world. Jesus invited many to his tables, and in doing so, he assured them of their place in the illogical realm of love and grace. He just wanted them to be hungry for relationship, hungry to look across a table into another's eyes, to break open their lives, and lift a cup in the midst of the hard times and hear, "This is for all, and so this is for you, beloved." The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, any time and everywhere, to give thanks to you, O God. You created this world full of so much beauty and sorrow and called it good and called it enough. Although we feel lost at times, you are ever present. We doubt, resist, turn away, and rage, insistent on our own power to pull us through, and yet sure that we are to blame, making life seem like a confusing paradox. But you, O Lord, are patient. You are here to meet us, reside with us in strange and alienating times, always faithful, always present in this body and in this body. And so together we proclaim the praise-filled truth of your glory along with all of the saints. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. He proclaimed freedom to the bound, justice for the oppressed, grace for the lost, love for the prodigal. Through the life and ministry of Jesus, we can imagine and live into a community where all who struggle are taken into loving arms, and those who struggle to love are invited into greater compassion. We pray today for your creation. You entrusted the earth to the human race, yet we disrupt its wholeness with violence and corrupt its purity with our greed. Prevent us from destroying what you have made and called good, so that our children's children may inherit lands and seas brimming with life and beauty. We pray today for the people of the world. Preserve the people of every nation from tyrants. Heal them of disease. Protect them in disaster and war and famine. Help all people, all women, men, and children, walk in the ways that lead to peace. We pray for Starkville. Heal the rifts and fears caused by violence and racism in our streets and schools. Protect all of our children and give them lives of safety, hope, and joy. Feed our hungry. Comfort our mourning. We pray today for our country. Give wisdom to those who govern us, to our president and our Congress and our courts. Keep safe those who protect us from danger and form us as a nation where justice flows like life-giving water. We pray today for this church. Strengthen its leaders, sustain them, and give them the energy of your Holy Spirit so that they may give others new life and hope. Be close to those in our community who are sick and those who grieve. Eternal God, your love is stronger than death. We rejoice in the lives of those who have died in faith. Keep us in joyful communion with them until we join the saints of every nation gathered before your throne in ceaseless praise. We pray these things through, with, and in Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, he gave thanks, and he broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take, eat. This is my body that is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup and gave thanks to God, gave it to his disciples, and said, Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, and as often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me. And so you remember. We offer ourselves, we proclaim God's time. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered today and on these gifts of bread and fruit of the vine. May them be for us sustenance for our days, love for simple and ordinary lives, fuel for justice in this world. By your Spirit, open us to each other. Open us to the world, making us one in you through Christ, in the power of your amazing grace.
Take all of me as I am, so
Friends, the body of Christ, the cup of salvation. Friends, let us pray. Merciful God, we give thanks that you have invited us to this table time and time again. We give thanks that you have received us as beautifully fragile members of the body of Christ and have affirmed us as a community of faith. Lead us to live as faithful and dedicated disciples in service to all the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, amen. I now invite you to rise in body or in spirit to sing our hymn of response, Be Still My Soul.
Be still, my soul.
You may be seated. If you have an announcement for the congregation, you are invited to come forward to the microphone stand to share that.
Thanks to all the musicians for the beautiful music.
Yes, thank you.
I want to thank everyone that came to the International Fiesta yesterday. We had a lot of people show up. It was like the best day ever. So thank you all. And thank you especially to Alex and Bonnie and Rosie for helping out. They did a great job. And anybody wants to help next year, just let me know. Second thing is, next Sunday is our Intergenerational Sunday School. We've got some wonderful things lined up, and we need help from everybody. Next week, we'll be reminding you of all that, so please keep that in mind after church, Intergenerational Sunday School. And number three, John and I are taking a trip to Morton on Friday morning, so we're going to load up the van on Thursday. If there's any donations that you need to bring for Morton, the basement, across from the secretary's office is where they can be put. Thanks.
Also across from the church office, you have things that the Boy Scouts will be delivering tonight to the various food pantries around town. Tuesday morning, we have Bible study in the library at the church, and it's at 10:45, and we invite any of you to come and share with us.
And we will be needing people to sign up to help with the coffee hour. Thank you, Alexis.
Just wanted to remind you, these are back on the table where the bulletins were. Tomorrow, next Sunday is the last Sunday to order a Easter lily. So just wanted to make sure you remember.
We are approaching a busy week, a full busy week. Next week, beginning with next Sunday, check your inboxes hopefully tomorrow for an email from me with a full schedule of all of your opportunities to engage with your Trinity family during Holy Week. Some highlights, as Joan referenced, we will have activities for all ages next Sunday, as well as a special Easter egg hunt on Easter morning. Next Sunday, we are also going to celebrate the parish's 50th anniversary after worship. Good for you. And that afternoon, I invite you to join myself and a few other local clergy at Dave's Dark Horse Tavern for beer and hymns at 5 p.m. It is early enough for the whole family. Have a full menu. Bring your kids and eat some pizza. There's soda and water, and it's an all-ages event, and we're hopeful that this first time will be a success so we can make it a regular happening in Starkville of many churches gathering together. And then Maundy Thursday, that next Thursday, 11th, 12th, 14th, will be Maundy Thursday, and we will have a worship service here at 6:30 p.m. with a special choral cantata in collaboration with University Baptist Church. And then Good Friday, we'll have the Community Stations of the Cross at 9 a.m. downtown, and our sanctuary will be open throughout the day for individual prayer. And then we invite you, of course, to come back on Easter Sunday for worship, followed by a finger food potluck brunch. We rejoice that we are starting to enter a time, hopefully, where we can do some more of these normal things we used to do and try some new things. Friends, receive this blessing from our Lenten devotional book, a blessing for when you're in grief. Blessed are you, dear, dear one, doing this holy work of suffering what must be suffered, of grieving what has been lost, of knowing the unthinkable truth that must be known. This grief can make you feel on the other side of the glass from the world around you, a force field of different realities separating you. Yet blessed are you and yours, For yours is the one most seen by God, who breathes compassion upon you even now, who has walked this path and who leans toward you, gathering you up in the arms of love. Rest now, dear one, you are not alone. And now, may the God who loves all of creation, especially the broken bits, the fragile bits, and Jesus, our companion along this crooked path called life, and the Holy Spirit who loves to improvise in surprising ways, go with you and dwell among you and give you joy. Amen.